When thinking about high availability in the cloud, on the networking side, we have several tools, and we've dug into some of these already, but today we want to highlight one in particular. High availability means that to some degree or other, we're dealing with some kind of load balancing. Load balancing is where we evenly distribute the incoming network traffic load across a back-end set of resources. And the purpose of this is to provide high availability as well as determining that our backend is healthy enough to receive that traffic as well. And if not, take it out of the pool and then we can do some maintenance to get it back up and running. So as a continuation on our network connectivity series, we're going to jump in today to the Azure Load Balancer. I'm Dean Cifola and this is the Azure Academy. The Azure Load Balancer is part of the family of resources that are in the networking space. And as you can see here, there are quite a lot of them. The Load Balancer is focused in the delivery space and much like the Azure Front Door that we've already covered. And we are creating videos for the rest of these delivery resources, so be sure that you subscribe so you don't miss any of those. Now, the Azure Load Balancer comes in a few different flavors, and we're going to go over to the Azure Docs and check it out. Over in the docs page in our table of contents, we'll go to networking and then go to the Azure Load Balancer. And we'll click on this link for what is the Azure Load Balancer. Now the Azure Load Balancer is a layer 4 resource, and that's a reference into the OSI model. An easy way to think about this is if you consider the post office. The post office will inspect the outer packaging to determine how it should be delivered, but they're not going to delve deeply into it. And so layer 4 is where we can do transmit of basically any kind of port and generally any protocol to get data from one place to another. This is different than what we covered in our Azure Front Door video, and I'll link up here so you can go check that out if you missed that. Whereas the front door functions at layer 7 along with our application gateway, we can pretty much set any port that we want on our Azure Load Balancer, and there's other features and benefits that come along with that. Now you can see in our graphic here as we scroll down that the Load Balancer can be used in a public or internal manner. So I could have it outside focused on port 80 traffic coming in, and then internally switch that to something else. Most typically you would see a load balancer used in something like a clustering type solution, like SQL cluster or a scale out file server, doing something where you don't see layer 7 traffic or you don't need some of that deeper packet inspection. Let's jump over to the Azure portal and build ourselves a load balancer. So we'll click the plus up top to create a new resource and we'll type load balancer and we'll select that first one and then hit our create button. So we need to put the load balancer into a resource group and I'll set up a new one for this. We'll just call that my load balancer and then we of course need to give our load balancer a name. And again, I'll just call that my load balancer and we'll put that in the East US region. So we'll scroll down a little bit here and now we can see our next choice is what type of load balancer we will create, an internal or a public one. Now you can see that by selecting public, we have the section for creating a public IP address. But if we change to internal, then those go away and we will have only a IP address on our virtual network, which we can choose to be either static or dynamic. Then we have the option of choosing which SKU we want, and that is either basic or standard. When we choose standard, we'll get a blue box here reminding us that we need a network security group to allow traffic to our load balancer. And we also have the option at the bottom for using an Azure availability zone. And that would be dependent on what region you are in as to how many zones you have. And if there are multiple zones, then the load balancer can be zone redundant. So this time around, we're going to create a public load balancer standard SKU, and so we'll get a new public IP address for this, and that public IP address must also be standard. And we'll scroll down a little bit here, and we'll select our availability zone as zone redundant, and hit next. And I'll just add a cost center tag at the moment, and we'll hit next, and then we'll hit the create button. Now while that's creating, we'll go right back to the plus and create another one. And this one we'll call internal load balancer, again in the East US. Our type will be internal, our SKU is standard, and then we have to select what virtual network we're going to put this on, and I'll just choose my VNet and put it on the test subnet with a dynamic IP, and we'll make it zone redundant, and we'll hit next. We'll set the same cost code tag and hit next, and then we will create. All right, so we've got two load balancers provisioned, our public and our internal. So let's dig into each config. So in the public load balancer, at the very top, we've got our standard Azure stuff telling you what resource group, location, subscription, etc. that it's in. And over on the right side here, we've got the backend pool, the health probe, load balancing rules, NAT rules, and our public IP address. Over on the left in the settings section, we have the front end IP configuration, and that shows here our public IP address. Our backend pool, we don't currently have one yet. We'll come back to building one in a moment. And then same thing for our health probes, load balancing rules, NAT rules, outbound rules, etc. So we have to configure all of these things in order to make this work. Switching over to the internal load balancer, things look slightly different. You can see the main configuration set at the top is the same, but instead of a public IP, now we have a private IP address. And over in the front end IPs, we see that same private IP again. Then we still have to create our backend pool, health probe, load balancer rules, and NAT rules. Back in the docs for a moment, if we go to concepts in the table of contents, and then go to components and limitations. And over on the right side, we'll click load balancer SKU comparison. So we saw that there were different SKUs that we could deploy, a standard and a basic SKU. Here's the basic differences between the two. In a basic load balancer, we can have a maximum of 300 resources in the backend pool, but with standard, we can have up to 1,000 resources. That could be your virtual machine or virtual machine scale sets. However, one limitation there is that all of those machines that you're putting into this load balancer backend pool have to be in the same virtual network. Availability zones are available only within standard, and one more that I want to get to here, and that is HA ports. So let's click on that link and talk more about this for a moment. So what are HA ports and why should we care? So let's scroll down a little bit to why use HA ports, because there's a good diagram here to help us out. So when you configure load balancing rules, you have two basic choices. You can choose to configure these manually, or you can do it more dynamically with HA ports. This is basically where we will say whatever ports come across on the load balancer, as you can see in the center here, port 1 through 65,000. We're just going to say whatever comes through, balance it across the whole backend pool. Now that's very convenient, especially if you're using some kind of network virtual appliance for a firewall from another vendor, and you're not sure exactly what's gonna come in, but whatever it is comes in from the peers over on the right, is going to hit that load balancer, pass down to the backend pool, and then that flow will be symmetric so that whichever node in the pool picks up that flow, it's going to continue that conversation with that other system until that session is complete. So now that we've walked through the basic build of these load balancers, I'm actually going to delete them and we're going to provision this all over again, this time from a fully configured solution. So at the top here, we'll click our search bar and we'll type deploy. And then we'll select deploy a custom template. And at the bottom here, we've got load a GitHub quick start template. We'll click the little drop down for that. And I'll type the word internal. And we want the second item here, two VMs with an internal load balancer. And then we'll hit the select template button. We'll deploy this to our My Load Balancer resource group. And we just need to give it a username and password. And we can decide to change the VM name prefix if we want to, but I'll leave it alone at backend VM. And we're ready to deploy this. And we'll scroll down and check the box that says I agree, and we will hit the purchase button. So starting with the VMs, then go to the networking, and then we can see under the load balancing link which load balancer we are attached to. We can click on that to also take us into the load balancer. Now notice our configuration. This is an internal load balancer. We do have a backend pool set up along with health probes, a load balancing rule, no NAT rules at this point, and we have our private IP. So looking at the front end configuration, we just have a single IP. We can have multiple here, and you could do another one just by clicking add. We'll give it a name of ILB IP2. This will be again on our VNet that we already have set up. We can't span multiple VNets from one load balancer. And we'll select the particular subnet, in this case, the backend subnet, and we'll leave our IP address dynamic and click add. So that'll provision us a new private IP address on that subnet, and that should be done in just a moment. Now, while that is going on, let's look at our backend pool. And our pool, we can see we have two VMs in there right now. We can hit the dropdown to see what those VMs are. If we click on the line for the pool, we can see the pool's configuration, and it can be IP4 or 6. We can associate this backend pool to a virtual machine or a virtual machine scale set. Let's create a new backend pool real quick. We'll just call it backend pool 2, and this will be unassociated at the moment. We'll just hit add. And while that's going, we've got our health probe, and I've already added a second probe here. So here's what our original probe that came with the build looks like. You can set your interval for how often it will check the back end to see if it is healthy. And then if we find that two of those tests come back as a failure, the back end resource will be marked as failed. So then all the traffic would go to the other device. And then we have the load balancing rules. And it uses our front end IP address, which protocol we select, TCP or UDP, the particular front end and back end port, and they do not have to be the same. Then we select which back end pool we want, which health probe we want to use, and whether or not we want to use session persistence. Persistence has to do with what happens after the initial connection begins. When you have none selected, that means that any machine in the back end can pick up the next request. So the first request comes in, you talk to VM1. Second request comes in, you might talk to VM1, or you may go to VM2. The options that you can choose from are client IP and client IP plus protocol. So that means if I have a client device and that comes from IP 10.1, the next time that that machine makes a connection within that same flow, it'll talk to the same backend device. I can be further specific by using IP and protocol and say not only from 10.1, but 10.1 on port 8080, make sure that you talk to the same VM. So if 10.1 talks to port 80, it may talk to a different VM. Then we have the idle timeout, and this is after that session's flow has been initiated. How long do we wait for that flow to be idle before we mark that session as complete? We can close that off, and then the next time the request comes in from 10.1, it might go to VM2, and then you'll start the process all over again. And the last option here is for floating IP, and we'll come back to that in just a moment. So let's go back to the load balancing rules, and let's create a new rule. We'll call this SMB, and we'll use the same front end, and this will be the TCP protocol. We'll have this use port 445, going to the same back end, and we will select our SMB health probe. Session persistence we'll set for client IP and protocol, and then we have that option for direct server return. Now, if we go over the tooltip here, this is the feature that's generally recommended for use with a SQL always on availability group or a SQL failover clusters IP. And the purpose of it is that once you have initiated that original flow, so then all subsequent traffic in that flow will not actually go through the load balancer. You'd be talking directly to the backend server. Okay, so in this case, for just a simple file share, I don't need it, but be aware that you do need to enable this when you build the load balancing rule. So we'll hit OK, and that'll create our load balancing rule for us in just a moment. While it does, let's go to our jump box, and in our jump box, we'll open up a new web browser, and we'll go to the IP address of our load balancer's front end. And when we do, we are sent to the back end VM because this is port 80 traffic and our back end is currently healthy. So here we are on the web server. So back in Azure, we've gone into that VM and I'm going to restart this VM and we've refreshed the browser and now we're on VM1. Ideally though, you don't really care which one you end up on because both of the systems are in the backend pool and they should both be able to service all of your requests. And now we'll open the Windows File Explorer and we'll go to 10.0.2.6 and then we'll go to the share folder. And when we do, we're directed to the share on backend one because that's the one that we currently have a flow with. Back in Azure, we'll restart VM1 now, which will kill that session. And I'll just press the F5 to refresh our share screen here. And now we're on VM0. Back in our web browser, we'll refresh here as well. And now we're back to VM0. Back in the Azure docs, there's one more thing that I wanted to cover today, and that's how do we upgrade from a basic load balancer to a standard load balancer so we can take advantage of something like those HA ports. So in the filter box here on the right, we'll type upgrade, and there are three options that show up based on which kind of configuration you have, whether this is a public load balancer or an internal load balancer. I'll choose the middle one here for no outbound connection. And over on the right side here, we'll go to the download the script link, and we can download this from the PowerShell gallery, and we'll copy the command, and this time we'll open VS Code. We just have to run the script with a few different switches here. RG name is where your current load balancer is located, and old LB name, the name of your load balancer. I want this deployed into the same region, which will be East US, and I want the load balancer to be called ILB standard, and I'll use the verbose switch and press enter. And it's going out and discovering everything about my current load balancer. I'm going to create a new standard load balancer and then get everything connected. Back in the Azure portal, we see our original load balancer now next to our standard load balancer. So we'll click on the standard load balancer here, and we've got a new set of IPs in our front end configuration. Same thing goes for our back end pools, as well as our health probes and load balancing rules. So if we go to backend pool 1 and we select our VMs and their IPs, we see that we cannot do this because they are already associated with another load balancer. So in order to make the cutover, there could be some downtime involved. You can do this one at a time to avoid that downtime. So we'll go back to the original load balancer first into the backend pool, and we'll delete our VMs from the pool and hit save. And now that we've got that out of here, we can go back to the standard load balancer's backend pool. And now we can assign our VMs to this new backend pool and hit save. So let's go to our load balancing rules. Now, currently we have these two rules, so let's just verify that they work. Back in our jump box, we'll open a fresh web browser and we'll go to our new front end IP address and we'll hit enter, and we are back on our server. And in our file explorer, we'll go to the same address back to our file share, and there we go. Okay, so we verified that our new standard load balancer works. Now we want to set up those HA ports. And we'll take our second load balancing rule here and we're going to delete it. Since the HA ports is going to balance everything across a load balancing rule, we don't need more than one. So we'll go into our remaining rule and check the box for HA ports and hit save. So we removed the load balancing rule for our file share. So let's start with that. And we'll go right back to the share address. Still works. So let's go to our web page, 10.0.2.9, and that works as well. And since we were connecting to box 0, we'll just bounce that box so we see that the HA ports does fail over. And we'll refresh our browser. And now we're on box 1. And we'll go back to our file share and we'll just refresh that. And there we go. We're back on box 1. So the HA ports allows us to have all the benefits of the load balancing rules, but spanning across every port, making management a lot easier and allowing us to scale. So I hope you've enjoyed this look at the Azure Load Balancer. This resource is really diverse and allows you to work publicly or privately on your own virtual network with multiple kinds of configurations, including those HA ports, which will make your life so much easier in using this kind of tool. And we've got many more videos coming on this network delivery series, so please subscribe so you don't miss any of that. And if you thought this video was good or you learned something new, then give us a thumbs up and let us know. And while you're down there, you can give us a comment or some feedback on this video or other things you'd like to see the Azure Academy produce. We're just here to help you learn all about Azure. And if you'd like to get an email to notify you when our new videos come out, which is about once a week, then you can go ahead and click that email notification icon as well. And if you're looking for something more, you can go check out our playlists, or you can click over here on the top right. This video is our latest video, or you can go to the one on the bottom. And this is one that we selected just for you to help you keep growing on your Azure journey. Thanks very much for joining us today, and we will catch you in the next video. Happy learning.